God bless all of you. I am so happy to see you today. You too? Already. Thank you, sister, for that song, and brother Mitch. And thank everyone. We love to see you every moment, not only in Sabbath. Before starting my ceremony, and when you see the title, it is make you thinking and thinking, what is Armageddon? When? Where? And how it is happen? Is this is really war? Some people say Armageddon is the Middle East, and others say in Russia, and others say that's Gog and Magog. But today we will open our mind and our heart to see and to know what is Armageddon. Before we start, we ask all of you to bow your head with me to pray, please. Our Heavenly Father, we ask you today to open our heart and our mind for the message today. I ask you to close my mouth for my heart to talk. And then I ask you to stop my heart to talk in my mouth. In Jesus' name we pray. We know there is not a literally place in the world today called Armageddon. So what does the word mean? Well, the strongest translates it as the hell or city of Megiddo. And today, I am going to ask you to open your Bible in Revelation 16. It started by verse 12. That's our scripture reading today. And I am asking one of you has a loud voice to read these verses again. It is read before in scripture reading. But I ask right now, one of you has a loud voice to start to read Revelation 16 from verse 12 to 21.
And he gathered them together in a place called the Hebrew tongue Armageddon, and the seventh angel poured out his vial
Then in Revelation 16, we heard the name Armageddon, the struggling of good and evil. Now, remember what it says in Ephesians about what we are battling against. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we wrestle not against the flesh and the blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritually wickedness in high places. As a Christian, our life becomes a spirit-filled life, which means our battle then become spiritually battle, as our enemy, Satan, is a spirit being. So why would the Bible say that we battle not against physical forces, but against spiritual ones, and then say in Revelation that the final battle for us will be a physical one? It doesn't make sense. And we know that God is not the author of confusion. Satan knows he has a short time left. So he's mustering all his spiritual forces. Remember, he has millions of fallen angels on his side, which will climax with this great battle of Armageddon. The battle of Armageddon will be Satan's final attack upon the people of God all around the world. Remember that point. It is not going to be forced just in the Middle East. It will be a worldwide battle. When did Jesus ever say his people would be involved in fight in a physical war? Something that many Christians do is that they mistakenly take certain words in the Bible prophecy and apply them literally, like the mark of the beast. Many think that this is going to be a physical, literally, mark on our hand or first forehead. They say the word means a mark, so it must be a physical mark. And yet the word beast in Revelation 13 means a beast. So are we now to believe that we will have literally peace causing the world to worship them? No. We are to apply them in a spiritual sense, not a physically, because there are many things in Revelation that are symbolic, not literally. So if we look at the root meaning of Armageddon, we will see what this actually means. The Hebrew term, Har-Magdon, means a mountain of crowds or congregation. Now, there is another mountain in the Bible, Mount Zion, at the place where God dwells. In Psalms 48:2, beautiful for situation, the joy of whole earth is Mount Zion, on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. In Psalms 9:11, sing praises to the Lord, which dwells in Zion. Now, the prophet Joel also mentions a Mount of Zion as being the place where God's people are gathered. Joel chapter 2, verses 15 and 16, 23 and 32. Did you see what Joel said? Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. Now that the literally nation of Israel is no longer God's chosen special people. The term Zion is applied to Christians. Zion is no longer applied to a physical location on earth like Jerusalem or the temple. It is now applied spiritually to God's people. And who are they? In Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither bond nor free, there is neither male nor female, for ye are all one in Christ Jesus. Which is why Joel says, however, calls on the Lord will be delivered. The New Testament says clearly that we Christians are now the temple of God, the physical temple of Jerusalem. And the city was destroyed in AD 70 because Jews rejected Christ Jesus and were no longer His special people. Therefore, the place of Jerusalem in Israel lost its significance also. So, applying the prophecy of Joel above in a spiritual way, we learn that God's people who are scattered all around the world are gathered and are in His presence to receive His protection. Jesus said, the hour comes when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet at Jerusalem worship the Father. But the hour comes and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Do you see the significance of this? Jesus knew that the Jewish would reject the gospel message. And he knew that the literally city of Jerusalem and the nation of Israel would no longer hold any special significance with God. Instead, the true people of God would be worshiping God in spirit and the truth all over the world. Now, God is not only one who is gathering a people around the world. As we read in Revelation chapter 16, Satan is also gathering his people for the last great battle, the battle of Armageddon, between God and evil, between good and evil. Satan gathers the wicked to fight against God's people scattered around the earth. Did you see that it is said unclean a spirit like frogs come out of the mouth of dragon? beast and the false prophets, what do frogs use to catch their prey? Their tongues. So the unclean spirit, like frogs, out of the mouths of dragon, beast and false prophet, are false apostate doctrine. Please note, the dragon is Satan. See Revelation 12, verses 3, 4, and 9. The beast is Papal Church of Rome, and the false prophet is Protestant America, which we learned from the Bible study to do with America in prophecy. I hope everyone has this book, America in Prophecy. Now, have a good think about this point. Is Satan going to gather all the wicked of the world, and God gathers all the saints of the world to a relatively small amount in Israel for a physical fight? We are talking of billions of people. This just is not possible. No, the battle of Armageddon is one that is fought throughout the whole earth, not just in the nation of Israel. But what about the drying up of the great river Euphrates, mentioned in Revelation 16:12? Well, in the Old Testament, we have an actual account of God using Cyrus to divert the Euphrates River in order to capture, literally, Babylon. To end the 70 years bondage of God's people, and notes how God describes Cyrus in Isaiah chapter 45, verse 1. Thus said the Lord to his anointed, to Cyrus, in Isaiah 41:2, who raised up the righteous man from the east. God calls Cyrus his anointed one and righteous one from the east. This is to be applied in a spiritually way to the end times and the battle of Armageddon. Revelation tells us of another Babylon who captures God's people and oppresses them. But this is spiritually Babylon, and apostate religion that deceives the world into bowing down to her, the Roman Catholic Church. Throughout the Dark Ages, this Babylon captured, tortured, and murdered tens of millions of Christians who would not bow down to her. But in the last days, God will call her surrounding waters, the river of Euphrates, to dry it up, to deliver his people. But remember, the Old Testament account was a physical, local account of Babylon that happened, whereas this account in Revelation has a spiritually worldwide application. Water in Bible prophecy represents peoples and nations. Revelation 17:15. And he says unto me, the waters which thou sowest, where the world sits, are peoples and the multitudes and nation and tongue. The whole is spiritually Babylon, Roman Catholic Church, and the water represents the people and the nations that support her. Whereas the literally water surrounding Babylon, Euphrates, was just that literally water that had to be dried up or diverted, the water surrounding Babylon, the great in Revelation, represents his people. So, how are these people? Those who support and protect Babylon going to be dried up? Revelation 17, 16, and the 10 horns which thou sowest upon the beast, these shall hate the whore, and they shall make her desolate and naked, and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. The world kingdoms and the people who once supported and protected Babylon will turn on her. Why? Because the seven last plagues will start falling on them, and they will realize that they were deceived by her Roman Catholic Church, and will turn on her and destroy her. When the sixth plague falls, Revelation 16, 12, the people will then realize that they have been tricked by Babylon, and thus the water people, the surrounding protection that Babylon once had, will dry up to her destruction. This then prepares the way for the kings of the east, Revelation 16, 12. Now remember, we learned that Cyrus in the Old Testament, who diverted the river Euphrates to capture Babylon, was called the anointed one and righteous one from the east. The spiritual application of this point to Christ Jesus at his second coming with all his angels. Revelation 7:2. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. Revelation 17, 14. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and the King of kings. And they that are with him are called and chosen and faithful. In Matthew 25, verse 31, when the Son of Man shall come in his glory, and all the holy angel with him, then shall he sit upon the throne of his glory. So who are the kings of the east? That's in Revelation 16, 12. Describes, they are Christ Jesus, the King of kings, and all his holy angel, and the second coming. It is sad that so many Christians have their eyes fixed on the Middle East, the literary nation of Israel, where the hate filled sons of Abraham in the flesh, destroy each other with American and Russian weapons. The Jewish of the flesh are no longer God's chosen special people. Please understand that battle point. Study the 70 weeks of Daniel a few times to grasp this important issue, which will open up your understanding of the role of Israel and the end of times. What is the battle of Armageddon? It will be a worldwide spiritual war between those who support Babylon and those who follow Christ Jesus and his true word, which is described in Revelation 13. And he gave power to give life into the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and the call, that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he called all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their forehead. Revelation 13, 15, 16. So yes, there will be physical aspects of the battle of Armageddon, like the saints being captured and killed for not taking the mark of the peace. But ultimately, it is a spiritual battle that we are fighting against, not flesh and blood. So please take your eye off the nation of Israel, as the battle of Armageddon is not going to be fought solely in the Middle East. It will be fought all around the world. Instead, fix your eyes on the eastern skies, where our Lord and the Savior Jesus Christ will return with the armies of heaven to deliver us. We should be filled with joy at the thought of Christ soon appearing. To those that love his appearance, he will come without sin into salvation. We should be rejoicing because of that. Our believed Savior is about to come. So will men's hearts feeling around us, there should be rejoicing. But if our minds are filled with thoughts of earthly things, we cannot look forward with joy to his appearance. Brother and sister, when I was very young, I was very afraid when I heard this word, Armageddon. And I'm thinking, because my thinking is literally, it is physically, and very worried, afraid. Today, when I know the war of Armageddon, it is not physically, I feel in peace because I know there is a one, he will protect me. The one who is knows my heart. The one, he is split his blood for me and for you. The war of Armageddon. It is very huge because it is worldly. It is not in Middle East. It is not in the part of the world. It is for whole the world. It is between God and Eve. It is to show who is like Jesus. It show the one who connected and have faith and trust in him. It show the one who is love everyone. It is not only love who is love me. It is not only to love the one who gave me money. It is only for the one who has given me gift. But I needed to be like Jesus. Jesus loved his enemy. And Stephen followed him. He loved his enemy. And he prayed for them, even they stoned him. Do you love your enemy? That's the time for you. That's the time for you to love your enemy. When you love your enemy, you live in peace. When you love your enemy, like the Bible telling us, it is a fire to put water in it. It is a fire to put water in it. I know a little story. And this story in our country. The administrator of the government, he was a Christian. And the whole government, it is Muslims. One day, the brother of the administrator government ride his horse in the street. And there is a Muslim in the street. Talk bad word against him. And he knows this man is a brother for administrator's government. And the brother, very sad. The brother, very sad. And he went to his brother, the administrator of government. Told him the story. And he asked his brother to kill this person. And his brother told him, no, I am going to cut his tongue because his tongue is made against you, not the whole body. His tongue only hates you. And then next day, the administrator of the government ask the people to bring a camel and put rice and macaroni and everything in this camel and sent it to the Muslim man. and told him, this gift come from the administrator of government. And the next day, his brother ride a horse and went to the same street, and he finds a Muslim man bow to him. And he amazing. Really? My brother cut his tongue. And he back to his brother. And his brother told him, I needed to know. Do not take evil by evil, but take good by good. From this story, we know how to love our enemy. We know how to love our enemy. Our enemy, it is not hard to, you know, to treat it him. Our enemy, it is easy through Jesus Christ to use the word to overcome him. And we understand how Jesus learned us. How Jesus learned us to love our enemy and to treat them. And we are not recognize what Jesus is telling us. Armageddon, it is between good and evil. And what we needed to do is to be in the side of Jesus, to overcome. When we did what Jesus commanded us to do, he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. I'm going today to do appeal. As we are in the end of the days, we needed to have a pure heart. We needed to have a pure heart. And a pure heart, it needed to be a pray for it. If you would like to have a pure heart, and we needed to pray, please come forward here. If you needed to have a pure heart, come. Ask Jesus for it. Please come. We needed to have a pure heart. We needed to live our life before. We needed to be one in Jesus. We needed to be as he are. His love and his joy, it is let us enjoy in peace. Please come forward. I am asking one to pray. With the Holy Spirit, it chosen him to be pray. Come, it is not me. It is not the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit convicted us to be had a pure heart, to be one in Jesus, to be in unity and love each other. Please come forward. Come, come. The time is short. Jesus coming soon, and we needed to be ready for his coming. I am going to ask Brother Anderson to pray to end our session.
in your name, help us that the Lord may go forward throughout this day and through this week, so that we can present ourselves back in this place when you come and sat. Be merciful unto us, O Father. Be merciful unto those who are in school, who are trying with their finals and who are graduating. Be merciful unto the wives who refuse to come to church today. Father, the husbands, the sons who are wayward. The pastor, we don't know who will at this time, but we are asking your blessings. We are asking a special blessing upon the elders, the leaders of this church. The assistant pastor who broke the bread today, oh Father, he's doing his best. Touch him in a special way. We pray.